Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to What I Review. It's been about a month since I last did one. I've been keeping up with the reviews as of late because, you know, fuck me and all that. It's a review-centered channel, what do you expect? Sort of, so to speak. Regardless, if you're not familiar with my What I Review series, it's where I find new and interesting games on Steam, or games that I personally find interesting, not just on Steam, but yeah. But it's where I find new and interesting games, or games that I personally find interesting and want to cover, and basically, you know, as the title says, review them. Because I don't like using the word critique most of the time. Do other times, but what can you do? Anyway, regardless, my name is ZalotAngel, and welcome to What I Review of, let's not butcher the name as always, because I'm fucking British and we butcher names all the time. Welcome to What I Review of Hyperdevotion Noire Goddess Blackheart. That is a fucking mouthful. Only Idea Factory can get away with name titles like that. Of course they can. What is it? It is a... Surprisingly enough, it's not a JRPG for once. In fact, it is primarily a strategy game. Surprised, aren't you? We'll go into that later on because there's a lot of elements of the strategy that I really want to discuss. It is developed by Idea Factory and Complie Hearts, and I think another company on the side as well by Spite, I think. And it's also published by Idea Factory. Its original release was on the PS Vita back in 2014. I think May 29th, 2014. Its original release was on the PS Vita, and it recently got ported to PC, I think, Tuesday. So, yesterday, basically. Yeah, there's a lot to discuss about this because we got going for options menu as we always do for first things first, because options menu PC game, of course, we're going to be discussing the options menu. You can skip to gameplay if you want, but it's kind of customary you actually sit and listen to options menu. I will be playing this with a controller because I always say, like, I always test either keyboard and mouse and controller, and I always pick which will probably be the best option for what I'm currently doing. But yeah, I'll be playing this with a controller, we'll get into that as well later on. First start options menu, audio sliders for everything, which is becoming prominently quite standard lately. But as anybody will tell you, separate audio sliders is always beneficial, regardless of what it is. You have different voices from English to Japanese. Voice acting, I don't really need to show off the voice acting because if you're familiar by now or seen any of my past reviews, you should know by now that the voice acting is actually top notch. I have criticized English voices before, my but that's just me. That's personal opinion. Secondly, again, there's a lot of strategy element options in here in the options menu, so going over them. Auto deploy, which I don't fully understand, is like automatically deploys. Fuck me. It's not like, what, 10 minutes and I'm already flubbed the words? Jesus Christ. Auto deploy, depending on if you have that turned on, it will auto deploy characters into battle depending on the certain criterion that you pick or depending on the scenario. Camera rotation, I immediately tell you to turn that up to 1/8. Immediately, because if you play games like XCOM, you know that rotation is really fucking annoying when you can only rotate on a 1/4 angle. Fucking annoying. And as well, because it's a strategy-based game, of course, there's going to be a grid base. It's grid-based, of course. So I always turn that on because it's nice. Grid color. What's the grid color? Fucking purple, motherfuckers. Of course it is. And display the dialogue boxes when the characters complete a challenge. Always like to have that on. Standard stuff, basically. And then the second option is basically just extra stuff that you can turn on and off, really. It's kind of self-explanatory when you kind of pan over all of it. Now, options menu. You may see some fairly fucking interesting here. Because this has got to be the most complex options menu that Idea Factory have put out for one of their games for once on PC. Oh, but there's actually a lot of interesting stuff to discuss about the options menu. For starters, you have full screen, windowed, and borderless. The resolution goes all the way from 640 by 480 at 60Hz all the way up to 1920 by 1080 at 60Hz. Yes, 60Hz. I have a 60Hz monitor. Not all of us are rich enough to afford a 120Hz monitor. Thank you. What I like about this is, yes, I'm playing in windowed mode, and yes, I'm playing at 1920 by 1080. Do you want to know the fucking surprising thing is? If I play a game in windowed mode, I want it to stay in windowed mode. A lot of games have this thing where the resolution, if you set it to 1920 by 1080, it automatically puts the game's window to full screen. If I pick windowed mode, I want it to be in windowed mode for a fucking reason. Like that. Did bugger up a lot of the recording, though, because having to set up the recording for that is kind of buggered up in that aspect. And then you have a couple of graphical options. You have Edge, which I don't know what the fuck that is. It doesn't really do a very good job at explaining what that is. Switch between objects, Edge, display, style. And what does that mean exactly? I don't fucking know. Detailed shadows, which is obviously, you know, just shadow detail. That's all it is, just detail on the shadow. And holy shit, we have anti-aliasing. What kind of anti-aliasing do we have? I don't fucking know. It just says anti-aliasing. You're probably thinking maybe it's just standard anti-aliasing. Possibly, but to be perfectly honest, there have been a couple of games that have come out with a similar kind of art style that have gone up to stuff like TXAA or FXAA. And for quite standard, I cannot tell if it's normal AA, FXAA, TXAA, SO, AA, you know, so on and so forth. So just gonna have to assume that that is just basic standard anti-aliasing, which is still nice to have regardless. So yeah, so options menu actually has a bit of effort put in this time for once. Frame rate, if you want to know about the frame rate is about 30 FPS. It is not hard locked or permanently locked to 30. It does sometimes go higher than 30 by maybe a couple of frames, but it is locked to 30. That's why if you're watching the video right now, you can see that I'm recording this in 30 and not 60 for that exact reason. Which kind of baffles me, speaking that Idea Factory's previous games that they've, you know, published all the way back to, I think, Rebirth 2. Don't quote me on that because I don't remember what Rebirth 1's frame rate was like. But I remember Rebirth 2, Rebirth 3, Action Unleashed all having 60 FPS. You could state that. Maybe it's the fact that this is ported from the PS Vita. So were the other games. All the others originally came out on the PS Vita. And for that matter, I can say without a doubt, having getting Rebirth 3 originally on the PS Vita when it originally released, the frame rate was had issues on that. So I wouldn't state the fact that just because it's a PS Vita release originally and ported over to PC that the frame rate is locked, like just stuck at 30. No, I don't think that for 1 second because the others were 60. On PC, and they were PS Vita releases. So yes, it is at 30, it is fucking noticeable, but I'm the type of person that can tick or leave 30 FPS, really. I don't really bother too much about that. I just like to point it out and state things, as you know. I've delved through the game system files and a little bit into the game's code. I haven't really found any sort of way to increase it, so maybe someone will figure it out. I don't know, but caution when advised, it does run at 30. You do have keyboard and mouse controls, but for some very weird reason, keyboard and mouse controls, right? You're probably thinking, can I rebind the controls? Well, I've currently got the option set to controller, right? Let me go down to remap. Can I remap the controls? I am mashing the fucking A button. Let me remap the controls. Pushing left or right. Cannot remap the controls. What the fuck is going on? If I swap to keyboard and mouse, I can still use a controller, I click remap, and then it fucking lets me do it. And if I get my mouse pointer, which is fucking annoying that you can see it, there you go, but can I still change them? It's like, well, I can and I can't, like, I'm wiggling the analog stick, can you hear that? Yeah, you see what I mean? It's like, I can and I can't rebind the controls at the same time. It's absolutely bloody confusing of, and like, What is it doing? You know, it's like, I don't know, but apparently you can rebind keyboard controls, but you cannot rebind controller controls. Why? I don't know. So regarding the options menu, it's actually decent for once, other than the fact that it's running at 30, other than the fact that you can't rebind controller controls, but you can rebind mouse and keyboard. Now, the difference between mouse and keyboard controls and the controller controls, we'll have to see once we get into the game and I can show you that, but overall, I'd say it's decent. Performance so far is, I've had no frame rate issues, no stuttering, no freezing, and no crashing, so performance is fine. At least through my experience, it's proven to be actually quite fine. And no issues on my part, but we'll discuss a little bit more once we get into it. Right, we are gonna see a lot of things that are very, very different from what you probably have expected to see. Caution to the wind, I am about 5 hours in. I have not finished it yet. In fact, this is probably the only one in the entire franchise that I have not played yet. So this is all new to me as well, so bear that in mind. But this is about 5 hours in, so yeah. So we're not really delving into spoiler territory, because one aspect of this franchise that you must be familiar with is that there is a fuck ton of dialogue. There is a lot of dialogue, more than you would expect, to be honest. If you're the type of person that doesn't like sitting through dialogue and prefers to get stuck into the game, then you're probably going to be in for a bad time, because there is a lot of dialogue. There's a lot of dialogue in this franchise, so you better be accustomed to that. Sorry for clearing my throat so much, I know that's very annoying, but fuck it. I'm going to be talking here for a while. But yeah, this is slightly different to what you might have probably seen in the previous releases. Oh, because this time, as it probably is quite painfully obvious, if you haven't figured out from the title and the splash screen and so on and so forth, that this, it doesn't follow the standard premise of what you probably expected of like the Rebirth games or any of the most recent releases that have come out. No, this is a game that is purely, instead of being centered around your typical characters this time around, this time the whole game is centered around Noir this time, which goes into the strategy elements, which I will get into once I actually show off the combat, because that's where it gets fairly interesting. Now, hub area. This is the hub area, because you actually have a hub area this time around, which it's still very standard and still very familiar if you are familiar with the franchise, of course. But this time around, instead of having a world map, what you would do is you would normally go to the quote-unquote guild and pick the missions from there, instead of having a world map that you can wander around or select or anything like that, which is okay, fair enough, whatever. But you still got your standard stuff, shop. Don't really need to explain the shop, because I think you know what that is. Played any sort of fucking RPG or anything like that, you know what a fucking shop is. Now, I will go through all these first, since it's the most obvious. Now, first thing to go and talk about is the disc development, because I thought, fuck it, we'll talk about everything in the hub first. Throughout the entirety of the game, you'll come across game discs. Excuse me. You'll come across game disc, and you'll come across chips. Idea chips. Okay. Now, basically, how these work is each disc has a specific level chip that goes along with it. And you can basically just slap together any sort of chip onto it within the appropriate level. See, that's a level 1 slot, cannot fit a level 2 slot. And each one of the chips have their own benefits, as you can see at the bottom of the screen down there. Lowers enemy shot resistance, and lowers enemy flash resistance. So they are basically allows you to kind of add buffs, basically. It's sort of a system where you get to create, well, shall we say, you burn discs, because, again, meta as fuck. It's basically you burn discs and they provide buffs depending on what you pick, which can be helpful depending, because, again, some of them are helpful, some of them not so much, because some of them don't really do a very good job at explaining what the fuck they are. I mean, what the fuck is shot resistance? What's flash resistance? What the fuck are that? Well, these are all damage reduction, so that's pretty standard. But what the fuck is shot resistance and fucking flash resistance? Let me find a red one. And, yeah, so you've got stuff from enemy attacks to enemy types to stuff that kind of buffs the characters in general, from status ailments to health to SP and stuff like that. Some of them, the yellow ones in particular, don't do a very good job at explaining, but the way it works is you get one, you don't have to fill up all the slots, that's kind of customary as well. Let's just pick another one, fucking Yandere, why the fuck not, and then let's pick a high level one, just for shits and giggles. Special moves will cost less LP to use. Once you do that, burn the disc, hit enter, you can name it whatever you want, and there you go, disc burn. And basically, yes, this is a aspect, this is an element of the game that's practically been in all of them, I think. I don't remember if Action Unleashed had it, but this is practically an aspect of the game that's been in almost every single game, so it should become fundamental and easy to understand if you've already familiar with them. Now, there's also another thing to point out, that the art style is actually very different than, again, any of the other games. To quote the Steam store page, they went for a kind of chibi art style this time, or as they call it, chibi style. If you're not familiar with what chibi style is, it is basically taking a normal character, shrinking their body down and making their heads bigger. So their head would be bigger than their bodies. That's what chibi style is. And that's what they kind of went this time with, this kind of chibi art style for this game in particular. I will actually show you in the equipment screen, because that will allow me to actually show off the disc burning as well. Yes, that is a chibi art style, which I think without a doubt anybody can tell you is fucking adorable. How the fuck can you stand there and tell me chibi is not fucking adorable? There must be something wrong with you. Which is a very, very, very curious design choice. I wonder what made them go for that decision. I honestly couldn't tell you. But as I was saying, once you burn a disc, and you can basically just slap it on, and you get the buffs down there at the bottom. And let me find an empty slot, just because I feel like it. Boom, slap that on, and now those status buffs work. It's really as simple as that, honestly. It's not that hard. And yes, as well, if you're familiar with the franchise, you may be familiar with the amount of references, parodies, and the meta kind of humor. I mean, for fuck's sake, we come across a character very early on in the game who is a blatant parody of Chun-Li from Street Fighter, which is... Yeah, and I'm guessing another character is a blatant parody of Solid Snake from Metal Gear. Yeah, if you're not familiar with this franchise, it's full of fucking parodies, references, and just meta humor and fourth wall breaking. Again, if that's an element that doesn't really appeal to you, then unfortunately, that's all these games are fucking full of, unfortunately. Anyhow, next thing, item development. Kind of a crafting system, shall we say. We're just going to call it a fucking crafting system. Now, as you play, of course, the standard of a lot of RPGs, you gradually pick up items from battle and stuff like that. And in this game, they have a purpose for creating items that you get during the disc development. Once you meet the requirements, basically do that, then boom. Now, the way this game works with this item development is once you've created one of them, and you've created it here by the little pink tick mark that you can see there, once you build it for the first time, it is permanently added to the store, so you don't have to keep building it. Fucking helpful, I'm telling you. And that's basically just that. It's really, again, as simple as that. You pick up items from fucking everywhere and you just build stuff, and once you build them the first time, they get permanently added to the store, so you don't have to keep building them repeatedly over and over again, which is a nice little touch, which again has been implemented in practically every single game. Now they've added something which was very curious, and I'm going to talk about this a little bit because it's interesting to see how they've added this. Not what I'm about to talk about, but something else, but I'll get into that. There's two more sections here which kind of confusing. You got the hotel and you got the Basilicon. What's a Basilicon? It's basically a simulator sort of thing. It is basically a simulator. Not to a ridiculous extent of what you'd expect to see on Steam. If I click that, it literally tells you at the top left up here. You get given a barren room when you start off. And you can basically redeem points, and the points you get, the sim points, you basically get just from buying items in the store, and you gradually just add furniture. And yes, I see the reference at the top, amazoo.net. Okay, it's a parody of fucking Amazon. Got ya. Very clever. So you basically just redecorate the room. I've only renovated it for, like, once, and that's that. And you basically just keep renovating and adding items to the point where, I don't know, probably where it looks fucking gorgeous, probably. That's my guess. Requests? I don't have any requests. I wish I had some to show off. But basically, every now and again during... I don't know when they come in. I think they come in between chapters. I'm not entirely sure. But every now and again, you get given requests. And the requests are not like quest missions where you go out and do something. No, it's basically pick one of two answers. You get given a specific quest that provides you with a topic, and you have to pick a response. And depending on your response, well, basically, it's got that whole relationship system sort of thing, and something like what I talked about in previous, in a lot of games that kind of hide it in there. I know Symphonia had that element of sort of... dialogue choices affect the affection sort of thing. Yeah, sort of thing. But you may notice that the answers are coming from a quote-unquote player character, which we will get into later on. And yeah, it's peculiar indeed, but and you know, you can also interact as well. Did I also... What? You can get 35 types of items. And if you clear it a second time, you get a comment. Why is a cushion talking to me? There's a sentient cushion here. What the fuck? Okay. Fair enough. There's a sentient cushion. I've seen it all. Oh god, what the fuck was I saying now? Oh yeah, I know what I was going to say. Yeah. This franchise also very much loves falling upon the whole Japanese character type, so prepare to spend about, I don't know how many hours, I have no idea how fucking long this game is, but prepare to spend God knows how many hours with a Tsundere character type. I know a lot of people have a particular fancy for Tsunderes. I'm more of a, to be perfectly honest, if I were to admit, I'm more of a Kundere myself, but... prepared to spend God knows how many hours with the Tsundere. I know that gets a lot of people off, so fucking go crazy with that. Okay, enough about talking what gets you off. Not really the type of topic we need to be discussing. And the CPU hotel is basically where everybody in your party basically goes. It's just another form of interaction, same thing. They don't really say anything new so far. I'm like two chapters... Well, I think I'm about three chapters in, I think. I don't know. Yeah, I'm about three chapters in or so, like two or three, and they haven't really changed their dialogue. But it's just casual interactions. You know, it's just like similar to what you're seeing right here. Just... Yeah, it's just random dialogue, really, that kind of does and kind of doesn't serve purpose. To a certain degree. And again, yes, you may see a lot of fucking parodies and a lot of references. Like over here, for instance, we have a very obvious parody and a reference to Kantai Collection, which is fan. Even her name is Fune, which is, yeah. A little bit on the nose there, Compile Hearts. A little bit on the fucking nose there, don't you think? But yeah, there's a whole bunch of characters that are just parodies of... video games, anime, and video game companies. And consoles, let's not forget consoles, because that's the kind of fucking bread and butter. Anyway, the way you get your missions now is instead of having a world map, because that's your central hub area, is you accept missions from the guild. Like I said, I've already done a couple just to try and get in. And yeah, the world map... Why is it the world map in almost every fucking one of these games keeps changing? I mean, I understand that this game, I'm guessing, is set in a completely alternate fucking universe. Because it serves absolutely no purpose to the original plot. And when I'm talking about the original plot, I'm talking about... like, the originals. Like, going all the way through to, like, Rebirth 1 through all the way through to Mega Dimension, basically. Whereas this is kind of a spin-off title. So are a lot of the others, so... But you basically pick up your missions from here. And, of course, which is a nice little thing, you can even go back and... replay past missions. As they call it, simulations. I mean, look at her name. Leafy. Yeah, nice little reference to Chun-Li there. Very clever. I mean, if you see her character design, you will see that it is blatantly fucking Chun-Li. Oh, bollocks. Anyway, we'll dive into combat because I think I've talked enough about everything else, and I'll, because the combat is going to be a lot to fucking talk about because it's strategy and I'm not that familiar with strategy, so this is going to be bloody fun. At the start of every mission that you are given, you're given an obvious win condition and loss condition, or a lose condition, however the fuck you want to pronounce that. Simple standard stuff, defeat all enemies, lose condition, all allies are defeated. This is just a standard easy fucking mission to do, because I'll do a story mission after I've done this one, obviously to show off the voice acting. So again, this is early on in the game, but again, spoiler warnings for when I do that. Oh boy, there's a lot of shit here to test. Fucking strategy elements, goddammit. Now, when you start off every mission, you are given, depending on the certain situation, like with story missions, those can differ. But a lot of these side missions, so to speak, give you options. Now, you can take four characters into battle, and you basically have to pick... First of all, the first thing you have to do is pick a leader. Now, if you see on the right side of the screen there, depending on which one you pick, has different kind of effects, different kind of buffs and debuffs. Like, for instance, +1 to movement, but -10% strength. Not really recommended. Critical rate up, level 5, strength up by 15%, intelligent up by 15%, HP is x1.5, but mentality is down by 10%. You get the idea. So first things first, at the beginning of every battle, you have to pick a leader. I always go for Vert. Strength up by 15%, intelligence up by 15%. I think that's a no fucking brainer, obviously. And then you just pick three other characters you want to take in. Now, don't worry about the whole idea of, do I need to take a specific character in to level them up? No, that doesn't matter. You can basically take whoever the fuck you want into battle. All the characters in your party will gain XP regardless of who you take in. So, just go for random here. And obviously you can choose the equipment beforehand, positioning, which is, you know, if you've got a bigger battle arena, excuse me for that, you can just move them around and position them quite easily. All the statistics, library, battle begin. Now, what kind of strategy are we looking at here? Are we looking at Civ 5? Are we looking at XCOM? Are we looking at Agorist? Well, what it basically is it kind of comes across as many different things, really. If you're expecting, like, XCOM level, don't. If you're expecting Agorist level, don't. It is turn-based in the same sense of XCOM, in the sense of how it's your turn, then the enemy's turn, and then rinse and repeat, so on and so forth. As you can see, you've got a big grid of, don't know how many squares, and it's literally just this area. Yeah, and do you remember why I said you should have the camera set to 1/8? This is why. XCOM ain't got nothing on this shit. Just saying. So basically, it's, you pick whoever you want to go first. It doesn't really matter who, actually. It just depends on who you want to go first, really. Now, if I press B, you can see the whole range here of the area in which you can move in. Now, whoever you pick to start off with, you obviously get a big selection here. You have normal move, which you can move within this specific grid. You have attack, which every character has their own specific kind of attack range, depending on the weapons and the skills. Skills, of course, as you see here, vary, again, depending on character. You have SP moves, which it took me a little bit to fucking figure out, because I kind of skimmed over the tutorial, my bad. Basically what it is, if you look at the top right corner of the screen, where's my mouse? There's my mouse. If you look at the top right corner of the screen up here, you'll see this little gauge with a heart next to it. Basically, you need to fill that up to be able to use that. And how do you fill that up? Quite literally, you need the characters to be in a kind of grid formation of like this, basically, where it's like it, covering all four angles. And you basically just need to do a skill. And that fills it up by, for some reason, I don't understand this, but for some reason it fills up by a kiss on the cheek. I'm going to roll with that and say, fine, okay, fan service people, awesome. Of course, items. Lift is an option where if you find, there are specific things within the map. There are things like this crate here and other crates and so on and so forth. And depending on the strength of the character, depends on how much damage they can actually do. But you can literally just pick up objects and throw them and move them around. You're probably thinking, what's the benefit of this? The benefit is there are some places which you cannot reach normally. It's like if I were to go from here to here, I can't reach that without first going here and then here and then all the way up there and there. If I had a box that I could put there, it would be much easier to get up on. Okay, right. I've dawdled enough just discussing all that. But that's basically the gist of it. It's really as simple as that. Now, if you press Y to go to the main menu, you are given options again to end your phase, you know, where you can retreat. There are some missions which will allow you to actually swap out characters in the middle of battle, which is always nice to do. But never press that. That will immediately end your turn, regardless if you've moved any of the characters. So, now, one aspect of this that I did actually find fairly annoying when I first started playing was it does have that element of XCOM where you pick an area and that arrow traces where the character's movement. Except early on in the game, when the game throws traps at you, because there will be maps which have traps on the floor, it didn't fucking tell me about how to change this like you can in XCOM. So if I wanted to go to here, but let's say there was a trap like here, like where the cursor is right now, there ain't no way of avoiding that, is there? Unless I press X to change the orientation to face left and then do it. The funny thing is the game doesn't tell you about that until like 3 or 4 hours in. Like, immediately after a battle which has fucking floor traps. Not really a good design decision there, Combat Hearts. Now, the way the movement system works is you are basically, you get given one movement and one attack. If you do your movement as your first turn, you can always immediately do an attack immediately right after. And if you do your attack first, you can still move afterwards. Which is nice. And that's it. Simple attack right there. And yes, you do that. You do get given XP every single time, even if you do fucking damage. It's awesome. Now, after you've used all your turns, then you pick a weight. You have to then wait, and you pick a direction in which you face. Like I showed you with the orienteering system. Like I showed you with this. Now, when you have to wait, you basically face a direction. Does this mean you get given defense? No, it does not. Basically, what this means is, if an enemy tries to attack you from the front, there's more of a chance of it missing and doing less damage. If they attack you from left, from either side, or from the back, it will has a higher chance of doing more critical damage and obviously more damage. The issue I find with that is because it's always your turn first, and because the AI is always programmed to attack your weak spot every time, that it just seems kind of pointless to even bother with that, because the AI will always, always go for your sides and back. It's almost completely pointless to even pick it. It literally is. Now, if you look at the bottom of the screen down here, with the attack, basically, you have your attack pattern here of the character in general is about to attack, which will do about 157 damage and it's 100% chance of hitting. Whereas the enemy has a 24% chance to counter, which will do 16. So that can actually happen where the enemy will actually counter your attacks and vice versa, where you will counter theirs as well. That's a one hit kill, thank you. Now, obviously, what reminds me a lot of this about, like, what reminds me of Agorist a lot is if you get overkills, you tend to get item drops as well. Not to mention the soundtrack also very, very much reminds me of Agorist. It really does. Now, the weight system. I know for a fact that fucking whatever the hell that is, I forgot the fucking vegetable that is. No matter if I pick up, left, or right, no matter direction I pick, it's always going to go for my sides, regardless. It's literally kind of pointless to even fucking, like, do it, to be honest. And yes, we are going to use Chun-Li, because why the fuck won't we? You see why I said she's basically Chun-Li? Yeah, that's exactly it. Now, once you've exhausted all of your turns, it's obviously the enemy's turn after that. Can't attack, okay. We'll do a stat buff instead. Now, remember what I was telling you about the bar at the top right corner of the screen? If you notice that when I hover over my skills, you see the hearts next to them that combine a total of about 25, 35, depending on skill. If a character is literally in one of these four angles, like up, down, left, and right, in any of the four directions, it will trigger this. You saw correctly. I got no comment. And if you look up, if you look in the top right corner of the screen there, it's filled it up partially. Now, the reason why you want to fill that up is because that allows you to do your SP attacks, and it also allows certain, like, If you fill that up, it allows you to do your SP attacks, and for all the CPUs, allows to go HDD. So it's kind of beneficial that you keep that up as much as possible. No more turns, enemy's turn. And you see what I was saying? Immediately to the left side. Immediately to the back side. Go on. And immediately to the back and to the side. You see how I mean that that system seems completely pointless when the enemy is always going to get around it? They are always going to get around it. But at the same time, yes, it does work in your favor as well. It's got its back to me. There we go. Yeah, so it does work both ways. But again, because it's always going to leave you open and leave the enemy open every single time. I don't know. Let me just deal with that. Now, as I was talking about, if you've already... The movement system comes down to... Depending on what your first action was, you are always guaranteed one move and one attack. It doesn't matter which order you've done that in. I did an attack there as my first, and a lot of games would just say, nope, you can't move. Well, I still fucking can, mate. It's beneficial, and it still works. And let me just finish this. There we go. Overkill. And there we go. That's the gist of the combat system, to be honest. And... it's still very, very, very curious to me. And yes, the challenge system returns. The challenge system is kind of beneficial, trust me on that. As you can see, the challenges themselves actually grant benefits. Literal stat upgrades is what they provide. If you do specific challenges, they actually provide proper stat upgrades. Now, as I was saying, I still don't really understand why they went with a kind of a chibi art style. Because they've never really done that. I can't really tell you, because I don't really know. Maybe it was just them trying to do something a bit unique with the original format. Probably. Do I have a problem with it? No, because chibi is fucking adorable, regardless. But yeah, so that's the gist of the combat system, really. The combat system itself is... it can get quite hectic, though. I mean, those very standard missions, which are the side missions here, don't really put up that much of a challenge. It's the actual story missions like this that can actually put up a real challenge. With, as you can see, specific win conditions and specific loss conditions and even different terrain. Like, there'll be terrain which have traps on, there'll be terrain that has different kind of, like, moving panels and switches you need to activate to move along, and so on and so forth. But again, I will just say right now, before we jump into it, spoiler warning, because I will be playing this story mission just to show off, A, the voice acting, and B, something else that I really need to discuss. You see what it says at the bottom of the screen there, where it says secretary? Yeah. I have a big, big, big kind of quibble with that. Not a bad quibble. Just something very interesting I want to discuss regarding that. But we'll get to that after this.
まだ有象無双の彼方。そうなんだよね。どうしようかな。勇者といえばレベル上げ。時間内で効率的にレベル上げられるかを競うというのはどう。それに決めた。いいよね、アイン。問題ない。何をしても勝者は変わらない。そのセリフ伝説的にムカつく。<笑>そう言ってられないようにしてあげるよ。じゃあモンスター退治に向かうのね。なら私たちも準備しましょう。
ええ、一応立ち会い人として、ついていった方がいいですわね。ああ、ちょっとノワール様、待って待って。何？他に何か決めることがあるの？違うよ。今回はノワール様に仲間になってもらおうと思って。勇者が旅をするときって、いろんな仲間と一緒っていうのが常識でしょ？伝説的に考えて。
Yeah, because that's standard for every fucking RPG. So fucking meta. Yeah, meta as fuck this dialogue. Always will be. Never change. Never change, Compile Hearts. Never fucking change.
うん、そうね。確かにそうかもしれないけど、エステルだけパーティーになるけど大丈夫？その程度大した差にはならない。我が黒竜の加護の前には無力。
See, I am just so itching to fucking blurt out what I've been dying to say regarding this for like the past 24 hours, but I am so trying to fucking hold it in because it's so funny and it's so clever what they've done. It's so clever what they've done. It really is. Because I know exactly, like, the whole secretary aspect is just so clever. Because it's a certain level of engagement, which I will discuss after this. So yeah, I can honestly say without a doubt, as always, voice acting is top-notch as always. You know, the voice acting itself, like, of course the original cast of voice actors, well, actresses, are gonna come back for, obviously, to play their roles, and it's always been good. I mean, even the English voices, even though I personally think some of them don't really fit, they are still good voice actresses. Very good voice actresses. So the voice acting is very good. Very, very, very good. There are still spoiler warnings here, so just to be sure. Now, same thing again. Pick 5 this time. Okay, okay. Boom. Go for Solid Snake. Liquid Snake, Phantom Snake, whatever the fuck. Whatever the fuck his code name is now. Right, so there's a bit of a competition this time. So yeah, the way it works is just that. Let me check something briefly. Defeat more enemies. Right, so I actually have to get involved. Oh, bollocks! I fucked up then by pressing end phase by fucking accident. Idea Factory, if you want something to add into this to kind of stop that from happening, maybe add a, are you sure? You know, XCOM has that where it's like, are you sure you want to end your turn? You haven't moved, you know, some units or some soldiers or characters. It's like, maybe add that in next time so I don't make a fucking mistake like that, like a fucking idiot. I'm a fucking idiot. I can't believe I fucked that up and pressed that. My bad, my bad, my bad. It doesn't have a very clear system for that, but it allows me to talk a little bit more about something else. But what I was talking about when it came to the secretary was... Who the fuck is the secretary? Well... He's... And it is a he, which is a fucking surprise. A male character showing up in this fucking franchise. I know, right? A male character showing up? Holy shit. Basically, He is considered to be the quote-unquote player character. In fact, that is established from the very beginning of the game that he is actually you, the player character. Now, I remember when I first booted this up yesterday and I was like, why the fuck is there a player character? There has never been a player character apart from PP, which I always forget the name of it. I know it's something perfection. I think it's Pitch Perfection. I don't know. That other Vita game that they made, which is basically a idle life sim sort of thing. I don't know. Yes, I have played it. Thank you. And that was the only other time they added a quote-unquote player character. Why would they add a player character? I know why. It's a simple kind of psychology sort of thing where they add a player character to make you feel more engaged, shall we say, within the story and the characters. And since this time around they've decided to put the prime focus of the game upon one character rather than, like, you know, so many, it has allowed them to do this sort of player character thing where... I'm trying to find the best way to explain it. So it's this sort of thing where when you add a player character, it adds that level of involvement into the game. It adds that level of personal involvement that you can project yourself onto the character, so to speak. Now, the reason why they do that is, as I said, it allows that level of you as the player projecting yourself onto that specific character and into the game. And the reason why they do that is so you can feel more engaged, more involved in the game's story and in the game's world by actually having a bit of yourself within the game's world. That's why they add that. Okay? Which is a very basic understanding sort of thing. Now, for this, which I know, again, as I said, sounds very peculiar for them to have it, because they decided to add the primary focus on one character now instead of so many, and because there seems to be that element that was in Pitch Perfection, where it's like you can actually build up some form of, like, friendship or some form of relationship with the character. And I get that kind of vibe from this, where they've added a player character for the sake of making him, you know, obviously boring, unoriginal, generic, to allow you as the player to project yourself onto, so you feel more engaged and more involved within the game's story and within the game's universe. That's generally how that works, and I see why they did that this time around. It's quite fucking clever, actually. Like, what other way can you get somebody involved, like, more involved into a game than allowing them to project themselves into a game? Exactly. How else can you do that? That's how it works. Mm-hmm. And that's how it's done. And that's why I said it's quite clever of them to do that. Because of them doing that has allowed you as the player to project yourself onto this quote-unquote secretary, making the game feel a bit more personal, shall we say, by allowing you to project yourself onto that character. Does all that make sense? And that's how that basically works, and I see why they've done that. Because as I mentioned, focusing primarily on one character this time rather than like 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 allows that level of involvement even more so than, as I said, than you would with having multiple. That's why I said it's quite fucking clever. But, I don't know, I found that kind of funny when I saw it, because I just, the moment I started playing, and the moment I saw that, I was like, yep, that's what they're doing here. Is that a bad thing? No, it's not necessarily a bad thing. Like, I don't think anybody can tell you that that's a bad thing. I mean, there's a fucking reason why visual novels sell as well as they do, for that exact reason as well. But that's a discussion for another fucking video. It's a curious choice, it's a curious design decision that they went for there, but whatever, you know, that's cool. It's not really gonna hamper the game in any way, as far as I'm concerned. But in general, After about 5 hours in, what you're seeing right now, this strategy sort of focus game, rather than it being a pure JRPG that you're used to, this is going to be the duration of the entirety of the game, so to speak. And again, as I mentioned, that is not a problem. You know, that is never a problem most of the time, shall we say. It can be a problem if it gets repetitive. Does this get repetitive? Again, it's a strategy game. What do you expect? Strategy games do and can eventually get repetitive depending on the situation at hand. But as well as, you know, with a lot of strategy games, it involves that level of tension, that level of some form of stakes being involved to a certain degree. But I can definitely see how it may lose its charm after a while. But again, that entirely comes down to how involved you are with the specific genre. You know? It entirely depends on your involvement with strategy games, how involved you are with them in general. Thank you very much. Now, as I mentioned, do I find the game itself to be fairly enjoying? Because after all the critical spectrums and all the critical discussions, can I say yes or no if it's enjoyable, yes or no? Based on my personal opinion, because we're at that point now where it's time for personal opinions. Personally, like I said, it's got the charm of the originals. Like, it's got the charm of all the other games. It's got that all that charm, the same meta type of comedy, the same kind of charm and comedy that you've grown to be accustomed with in this franchise. And I understand why they kind of went for a strategy focus this time for this particular game that is centered around noir. And you know what? The reason why I say that is because it suits her as a character for the game to be built around strategy because of her character, shall we say. Like I said, if you are familiar with the franchise, then you will actually know why. But that's just what I think. It feels like it suits her for this to be a strategy game because of that. Oh, fuck, that's gonna beat me. Yeah. So for them to focus primarily on it being a strategy game, I understand that because it actually fucking works, to be honest. But let's just fucking rotate. But at the end of the day, what really comes down to it is it enjoyable enough to warrant the purchase? As I constantly say, it comes down to what do you think about the franchise? Do you actually enjoy the franchise? Do you enjoy parodies? Do you enjoy references? Do you enjoy fourth wall breaking? Do you enjoy meta humor? That sort of thing. If you enjoy all of that stuff, like that, the dialogue and the story is going to keep you entertained for a very, very long time. Now, the strategy elements, again, I'm not that, you know, well known when it comes to strategy. You know, strategy games I've played involve like Civ 5, Civ Beyond Earth, Total War Shogun, I think, and XCOM. That's the extent of my strategy game knowledge. So I can't really tell you firsthand because I'm not familiar with strategy games, but again, from people who may understand strategy games better than I do, may be able to shed some more light on this than I could. But again, the standard thing comes down to, and I know this is a very lazy response that a critic could give, that a reviewer could give towards a game, but if this looks enjoyable to you, then fucking go for it. You know? If this looks enjoyable enough to you, then fucking go for it, mate. Because then you have, that's it for you then. You know, that's the game you want to play then. If it suits what you like, then go right the fuck ahead then. And since this is literally my first time playing this, because I've not played this one before, I would definitely say, yeah, I'm actually having fun with this. Will it eventually lose its spark? Probably from like small parts of repetition and so on and so forth, but Can I recommend this at the end of the day? Because at the end, every time we get to end a review, it always comes down to my personal opinion at the end. When I come, well, at the end of the review, shall we say. I would say I can actually recommend it. Because the strategy elements are fun. The quirky comedy meta humor is still there. It's everything you wanted. It's everything you'd expect to see in this franchise. Just with the combat turned into something else. It's not your standard what you'd expect. You know, it's more strategy focused, obviously. It looks fine. It plays fine. There's no issues or anything of the sort that I've seen. So, can I recommend this? Then, yeah, I can actually recommend this. I actually consider this to be alright, even though, as I mentioned, it's weird that it's running at 30 and not 60, but again, I can take a leave that. It is running at 1920 by 1080, and it is running at 60Hz on my monitor. It might go higher than that, probably. I don't know. I don't have a 120Hz monitor. But yeah, I can recommend this, so there you go. You can go pick it up for, I think it's £13 and I think 59 pence, because it is on sale. It is currently on sale till the 3rd of May. It is £13 and I think 59 pence, or your regional equivalent. On the 3rd of May, it'll go back to its normal price of like 21 quid or something like that. So yeah, I can recommend this. Can I recommend it over the others? Maybe start with the others first. That's what I'd say. Yeah. I can recommend this, but as always, thank you very much for watching. I've been whoever the fuck I've been. This has been a slightly different twist on the whole franchise, being somewhat focused more on strategy, but still the same kind of parody, referencing meta, fourth wall breaking sense of humor that this franchise has come to be very well known for. But as always, thank you very much for watching, and to Raya Faces. And as always, remember, if you're ever in this sort of situation, strategy. Strategy is always the way to go. Strategize and always fucking think ahead. Despite the fact that maybe some strategy might not be well accustomed to what you're used to. Ta-ra, your faces, people. Thank you for watching.